I praise your name. Thank you.
And we're able to sense God in so many wonderful ways. The Holy Spirit is God. And just like Jesus and the Father, He knows us and He loves us and He teaches us and He intercedes for us. And most importantly, He transforms us. When the Holy Spirit moves on our lives, it can happen in so many wonderful ways. I just want to go over a few examples of how the Holy Spirit moves in our lives. One of them that I feel today is just, you'll sense a deep inner peace. Some of you are facing persecution and all kinds of conflict may be going on around you, storms and whatever. But when the Holy Spirit is moving on you, there's a feeling of peace, of tranquility, a feeling of reassurance. Another way you'll sense the Holy Spirit is through personal revelation on your situation. You'll sit and you'll hear words, you'll hear a sermon, and then you'll sense the Holy Spirit speaking to your heart. And the words you're hearing are like a personal revelation on your situation.
Amen.
And you sense that no one but God could know how perfectly those words fit your situation.
Hallelujah.
Another way you'll sense the Holy Spirit moving on you is when you can't contain your joy.
Amen.
You worship, you sing, you move your body, and this joy bubbles up inside of you, and you just feel so close to God.
Hallelujah.
There's an intimacy, and you know the Holy Spirit is moving on you, and the presence of the Lord is sweet and loud. And then sometimes you're in a quiet moment, and the beauty of the Lord just causes you to just weep. If you've ever experienced that, you're not mourning, but His presence is so strong and so sweet and so lovely. You're just overwhelmed, and you're so grateful that you are enjoying the presence of God. Other ways of you sense the Holy Spirit is alive and moving on you. You're reading the words of the Bible, and those words are coming alive to you. They're jumping off the pages, and you know you're hearing truth. And you can't contain this word. You gotta share this word. You gotta encourage somebody. You gotta give them the wisdom from those words. Another way you can sense the Holy Spirit, you're in a room and the room is silent, but you sense something is off. People are angry. People are feeling bitterness and rejection and conflict, and you know something is wrong, and something inside of you is telling you, begin to pray right now, begin to intercede right now, begin to dispel this negative spirit. There's something wrong, and you need to bring the light of God in this situation. It's the Holy Spirit talking to you. Another way you may sense the Holy Spirit is you see someone isn't feeling well and you feel compelled to go and lay your hands on them and pray and say, I thank you, Lord, that they're healed. And later on you learn that person's fever broke or their symptoms have improved. And even if their symptoms didn't improve, their hearts were encouraged.
Hallelujah.
And they'll even come back and tell you, I needed that. I needed that. Thank you for being obedient to the Spirit of God, because I needed that.
Hallelujah.
The Holy Spirit moves in so many wonderful ways in our lives. And in every way that He moves, He always wants to show us God's goodness and to strengthen our faith.
Hallelujah.
So we're going to continue to rest on the power of the Holy Spirit today, the presence of the Holy Spirit today, the beauty of the Holy Spirit today, and how He moves in our lives. The Holy Spirit gives us power. He not only gives us power, He gives us power to do something that amazes us.
Hallelujah.
That we say, wow, that is God, and you're using me. Oh my God. He takes us out of our comfort zone, and we get this boldness to do things and to move and to go places and talk to people. And we're like, where is this coming from? I just like to get on the train and just sit there and just go to sleep. But I feel compelled. Compelled. You can tell when someone is screaming at you on the subway train, and you can tell when it's a move of the Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah.
I've experienced both. I've been on subways when I'm the believer there saying, God, I wish you would shut up. Everybody's been turned off, people are angry, it's just ugh. And then I've been on the train when somebody has a true move of the Spirit and people are silent and you can tell they're receiving. Mm-hmm. There's no anger, there's no I wish you would shut up coming out of people. There's just like an awareness that God is talking, that God is here. And there's an appreciation of the Spirit of God. And there's no rejection there. And I know that the Holy Spirit is moving on that subway car.
Amen.
And I will feel tears come down my eyes because it was so beautiful and so real. That's the Holy Spirit filling someone up with His supernatural wisdom and His supernatural courage. Here are some verses about the Holy Spirit and His power. Acts 1:8 says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. And Micah 3:8 says, but as for me, I am filled with power with the Spirit of the Lord. And Acts 4:32 says, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly. Pray for the Spirit, for the Holy Spirit to give you the power of God. Not to break chains, but to break brokenness in people's lives. To break ignorance off their mind. To bust in there and tell them there's a God and He cares about you and He can heal this situation. Pray for boldness, not to keep your mouth shut, but to open your mouth wide with what you yourself have learned about who God is. Pray for the power of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit gives us guidance. Jesus was led and guided by the Holy Spirit into the wilderness, and while He was there, Satan came, that evil spirit, and challenged Him. But each time the Holy Spirit guided Jesus to respond with the word, and each time and with every challenge, throw yourself down and kill yourself, and the angels will come before you, kill yourself and lift you up. Jesus would say, it is written.
Hallelujah.
He knew He had the power, but He didn't move by the power.
Amen.
He moved by the word of God. There are times when the word is what needs to be said there. The word of God is power itself. It's the dunamis of God. The power of God. The word will break Him. And He will cause the devil to flee. Because the truth is the truth is the truth.
Hallelujah.
The devil operates in lies.
All the time.
But the Holy Spirit operates in truth. So pray for the truth.
Hallelujah.
To operate in your life and out of your mouth. Let sweet water come out of your mouth. That's the truth. Nothing foul. Truth is sweet water.
Hallelujah. Amen.
People can challenge you, get up in your face and say, how can you believe in this and believe in that when all that's going on and all this is going on? And it can be intimidating to you, but don't be afraid.
Hallelujah.
Rely on the Holy Spirit and He'll put the right words in your mouth.
Hallelujah.
He's going to lead you to the places where you want to go, where He wants you to go, and to the people you need to talk to. That's why Minister King was there talking to a woman from the Muslim faith. All logic said, she can't talk to me. I'm a man. I'm from a non-Muslim faith. I'm a Christian. There's no reason she should have trust in me. But she is a hurting soul. And you know what? Even though she worships a different faith, the God of the earth, who died for the earth, knew her pain.
Yes.
And He saw her pain. And He knew that she couldn't talk to nobody in her family, nobody in her faith. So what does He do? He positions a believing saint around her. Don't you know that's Holy Spirit, divine appointment? Do you see that? Why should He care? He didn't say, I'm only sent to the believers. No, He did not say that, because that's not the Spirit of God. Because where the Spirit of God is, there is freedom. And He's not a God of denominations. He's a God who loves the living soul, and one of His daughters is trapped in a lot of things, and she needs relief. So He sent one of His angels her way, and He spoke encouraging words to her. He didn't say, well, first you have to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and then I'll share with you the wisdom of God and the love of God and the hope of God and the healing of God after you have received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. He said, Lord, my neighbor is hurting.
Amen.
Who's my neighbor? The person next to me. Not the Christian person next to me. Not the Baptist person next to me. Not the Assemblies of God person next to me. He said, who's the person next to me? That's the person hurting right over there.
Amen.
Do I need to know more, Lord? Should I wait? You know, because you know she's from another faith. She's confused. God said, go. Go in the power of the Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah.
And share. Share my love, my wisdom, how I care about her, and how I want her to be set free. The Holy Spirit will guide you. Pray for guidance.
Amen.
Pray that the Holy Spirit guides you.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit gives you joy. David danced.
Hallelujah.
Others sing for joy to the Lord. Like Jade said, you know, if we don't shout for joy, we don't praise the Lord, the rocks will cry out.
Hallelujah.
There's so much joy that even inanimate objects are going to cry out in praise.
Hallelujah.
So sing and clap and cry and tears of joy when the Holy Spirit moves on you. One of the most beautiful times that I've watched, I've felt the joy of the Lord is when the musicians are strumming and drumming and doing all their things. And they have like this language with God.
Amen.
And you feel it. And they're talking to God and they're strumming. And you know that it's a new language. It's a musical language of praise. And you can feel the anointing. And it's like, oh my God. This is so precious, so beautiful, so sweet, so lovely, so powerful. I love it when the musicians jam, not just to be jamming, but when they jam from praising.
Hallelujah.
So don't hinder and don't look down when someone is expressing joy, a supernatural joy from the Lord. Because they need that happiness. They need that sweet joy from the Lord. They need that release. They need that awareness of God's presence. They need to know that He is with them. And they need to just enjoy Him. And you can tell as they're strumming and banging and clanging and whatever they're doing, it's a language of love to God.
Hallelujah.
Another way the Holy Spirit moves on us is He brings healing. In the book of Matthew, Jesus gave authority to His disciples to heal every kind of disease and sickness. And in 1 Corinthians, He gives the gift of healing through the Holy Spirit. I have experienced being healed, and I have experienced being used to heal. And it freaked me out. Yes, it did. Some of you may have heard me tell this story, but it's an illustration, so you're just going to hear it again. Tradition. Because God is real. Even if He freaks you out. The Lord had my mom call me many, many years ago. And someone in the family had a toothache. And she said, she calls me Rita. She says, Rita, would you please pray for her? She can't, for some reason, she couldn't afford to go to the dentist. She didn't have medical coverage. And she was impacted and she was in horrible pain. And nothing. And she was either going to overdose on pills or whatever until she got to a dentist or got money for a dentist. Whatever the situation is, she needed help. And my mom felt led to call me and say, Rita, would you just please pray for her? So I'm like, well, I'll pray for her, but maybe we need to get her some money to get her to a dentist. That's my level of belief at that time. So in obedience, she puts her on the phone, and I begin to pray for healing on this impacted tooth. And I'm just here in silence. I'm just continuing to pray. In faith, but everything in my head is saying she needs to get to a dentist. So it ends, and somehow or other, whoever the person was, they smiled at my mother, and my mom said, Rita, she feels so much better. And I'm like, yeah, right. Okay. I know what an impacted tooth feels like. So I'm like, okay, Mom, good, great. And my mom said, no, Rita, she said she was feeling warmth in her mouth.
Hallelujah.
And the pain went away. And I was like, no sweat, really? I couldn't believe it. The Lord will use you in spite of where you are in your faith. You just need to be obedient. And I asked my mom afterwards, I said, when did she finally go to the dentist? She said, Rita, your prayer lasted the whole weekend. She went to the dentist 3 days later.
Amen.
She said, you prayed for her, and the pain went away. And I knew it wasn't me, because there's no way it was me. But it was the Holy Spirit working through me. I think I mentioned, after that, my mom wanted to call me every time somebody in the family got sick. And I was like, no, Mom, it's okay, it's okay. But the Holy Spirit will heal. He will heal. know that God has healed me several times.
Amen.
I'm still dealing with a chronic infection in my body, but I know what God has done. And I know there's a purpose for everything that we go through. It was so on target with some of the things I was listening to Jay say this morning during worship. Sometimes you go through things, and she said that God healed her of depression, but she went through a season where there was no healing. And I know that. I'm dealing with a chronic something. And I know that some of you are too. And I know that you get depressed about it. I know that you get frustrated about it. I know that sometimes you feel like you don't want to do anything. You just want to lay in your bed and pull the covers over and never come out because you're so frustrated by this thing. I know that you want to be normal. I know all these things because I'm going through what you're going through. Is that the reason why I'm going through this? I don't know, but I do know that I can empathize.
Amen.
Hold on to your faith. I'm holding on to my faith that one day this thing will clear up.
Amen.
Because I know that God is good. And I know that He's working together, all things together for my good. And I know that He has a purpose for this thing. And I'm going to endure because I know He's going to give me the grace and the strength until this thing is resolved. And like Jay, I can say, it's gone.
Amen.
Another way the Holy Spirit moves on our lives is that He gives us wisdom. And sometimes they come from dreams and visions, interpretations of tongues. And sometimes it's just a word of knowledge. He helps us discern a particular situation, and then He directs us to act and pray so that we can bring about God's will in our lives or in this situation. The thing is, we have to be willing. Because God can drop a sense to you, and you know this is God saying, go A. But your will has to line up with go A. What time is it?
108.
There's a story, it's a funny story, but it's in Numbers 22. And what that story, why I want to bring it to your attention, is it shows how you can be connected to God and still want to do the opposite. But in the end, God wins. It's the story of Balak and Balaam. I'll call Balak King B. For those of you who aren't familiar with the story, after the Israelites conquered Pharaoh and all his armies, they began to move across the land headed towards the Promised Land. And as they go along this journey, they meet many people. Some let them pass by peacefully, all these hundreds of thousands of people, but some they had to fight. And one of the kingdoms they encountered was the kingdom of Moab. And King B, I'll call him King B, Balak, ruled Moab at that time, and he feared the Israelites coming through his kingdom, and he wanted to destroy them. So he engaged a prophet to curse Israel. But this prophet ran into some difficulty. It's a very unique story because here we see a person who has the Spirit of God on them, but they struggle because they really want to get paid. King Balak, King B, was like, I'll pay you if you'll curse them. I know that you are a man of God and what you say goes. So it's me like saying, Mauricio, I'll pay you if you'll curse my coworker. So Mauricio was sitting there saying, so what am I going to do? I really want the money, but then I have the Spirit of God inside of me. But I really want the money. But the Spirit of God, I know God. I know God. I'm not so sure He's going to approve of this. What am I going to do? What am I going to do? What am I going to do? Because I really want that money. So this is the situation that Balak and Balaam and King B, Balak, So he sends for the fortune teller, Balaam, and he says, curse, King B says, curse them. And Balaam says, he knows God enough in this way. He's like, well, it doesn't quite work that way, King B. Yes, I know God. Yes, I have a relationship with God. But you know what? Even though I make pronouncements about things, unless the Lord is behind those pronouncements, it ain't gonna come true. So I can say everything I want. But unless God is in that, it ain't gonna happen. So King B says, okay, okay, whatever, whatever, but just go ahead and curse them. So Balaam goes on his journey, and he's headed towards Israel, and he's riding on this donkey. And every time he turns the donkey towards the Israelites so he can go and possibly curse them, the donkey turns off the road. And he does this three times. And finally, and every time that he does it, Balaam whips this donkey. Get back on the road. We got to go and get the money. We got to go and make the pronouncement. And hopefully God will, you know, be in agreement so I can get the money. So finally, this donkey raises up and he starts to say, why are you hitting me? God gave this animal the ability to speak. And what was happening was every time that Balaam was urging the animal on, the animal saw something. Do you know what he saw?
Angel.
He saw an angel of the Lord with a sword drawn. All right, now is that the will of God or not? Making itself evident. God will show you the will. Will you be obedient?
Amen.
Pray that God will show you his will, but also that you will be obedient to it, like the donkey. So, the donkey says to Balaam, am I not your own donkey, which you have always ridden to this day? Have I been in the habit of doing this to you? Meaning, not obeying him as he's urging him on down the road. And so the Lord opened Balaam's eyes, and he also saw the angel of the Lord standing in the road with his sword drawn. So he bowed low and fell face down. And the angel of the Lord said, why have you beaten your donkey these three times? I come here to oppose you because your path is a reckless one before me. The donkey saw me and turned away from me these three times. If it had not turned away, I would certainly have killed you by now. But I have spared you. So at this point, I think Balaam clearly heard what God's will was. And it was not that he pursued the Israelites to curse them. But King B is insisting. And one of the things that Balaam says to King B is he says, how can I curse those whom God has not cursed? How can I denounce those whom the Lord has not denounced? So he refuses to curse the Israelites. I want you to see the importance of this. When you have the Spirit of God on you, you must also ask for the will to obey him. In the end, Balaam refuses to curse the Israelites because he understood how God works. You see, folks, we can't control the Holy Spirit. We can't control God, no kind of way. And whenever he has determined that he's going to do something, or he has determined he will not do this, no matter how much you say you want this to happen, his way will prevail. Know that also about the Holy Spirit. Amen. Your arms are too short to fight with God.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit has a standard. He created us to be like Jesus.
Hallelujah.
And when we rebel and go our own way, even if we have a sense, you can't say you can't. But how many times have you said, you know, the Lord was trying to tell me not to do that, but I just had to do it because it was just in my bones. Well, I ask you, was it worth it? It's never worth it. It's never worth it to fight God. If you've been yielding towards any kind of negativity, God is saying to you now, be like that donkey who saw the will of God, who saw the angel of the Lord, and turned away because he feared what God was going to do. There's something going on in your lives, and something you feel that somebody deserves, or whatever. Turn. That's all you got to do with the Holy Spirit. Turn back and ask for the grace. Ask for forgiveness for this person or this situation. And ask for the Holy Spirit to fill you with His Spirit. Because when you ask for the Holy Spirit to fill you with His goodness, you're asking for the Holy Spirit to fill you with love and joy and peace and endurance and kindness and goodness and faithfulness and gentleness and self-control. Ask the Holy Spirit to fill you with more of Him so that you can do what God has called you to do and you can be who God has called you to be. The more you yield to the Holy Spirit, the more you will reflect the goodness of God in this world.
Amen.
Romans 8:37 says that when you submit to God in all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him who loves us. 2 Corinthians 2:14, thanks be to God who always leads us in triumphal procession in Christ and through us spreads everywhere the fragrance of the knowledge of Him. 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. 1 John 5:4, for everyone born of God overcomes the world. But you got to overcome yourself first. This is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. And in Ephesians 16 says, finally be strong in the Lord and in His mighty power. Apart from the Holy Spirit, you cannot experience an intimate relationship with God. Apart from the Holy Spirit, you cannot become the person God intends you to be. So today, pray to be filled with the Holy Spirit. You need strength right now? Pray for the Holy Spirit to give you strength. You need peace, joy, and wisdom? Pray for the Holy Spirit to give you peace, joy, and wisdom. You need healing? Pray for that healing. Do you want to stop going in the wrong direction? Pray for wisdom and guidance. And do you want to grow in God's character? Pray to be filled with His goodness and His love. And pray that He transforms your heart evermore.